Right. So, in last class we had finished off with the outdoor propagation model, in which we had discussed on Okumura and Hata as the two widely used path loss model or practical path loss model. And we had also done one numerical where we had compared the two model on the basis of finding out the L50dB or the attenuation, mean attenuation that is happening with respect to two different model. And we have observed the differences that an Okumura model, which is more of a graphical representation or an assumption we have to take in different for different parameters, compared to Hata model, which is a purely a model which is based on analytical calculation, gives us a much better approximation. Okay, that's what we proved. Now, this is the last segment of our discussion on large scale fading, in which we are going to discuss the indoor propagation model. Because if you can remember, in very first few lectures when we were discussing, the basic idea behind this calculation of all these losses were, the one very important factor was where we are making a measurement. So either we can make a measurement, if I write it, either we can make a measurement at outdoor environment, or we can do it at indoor environment. So these are the two possibilities. Now, outdoor environment ideally will have trees or maybe hills, okay, all these as the attenuators. And as I told you, these attenuators won't be present when we are making a measurement for an indoor environment. So indoor environment will have different sets, like suppose the building shape, okay, the materials that is being used in an office, or materials used in office building. So they might be different. You can observe that an office building will not be the same as that of a residential home, right? So based on this, the very similar manner, there is an attenuation factor model that we can actually predict, that actually can predict the total amount of loss that might happen for an indoor environment. Okay, so that is the main objective of this lecture. Now in this case, you can see there are certain limitations or some assumptions being made, and they are very important. Okay, so the first thing is this one, that the indoor channel are different from the traditional radio channels in two different ways. The first one is the distance covered are much smaller. So why we are looking at this is, like, when you are considering indoor environment, if you can imagine, in case of Okumura model, you just visualize the graph that we had. We had a separation between transmitter and receiver as in range of kilometers, 20, 30, 50, like that we went around. So it is in kilometers, whereas you will find that in indoor environment or indoor propagation model, we are keeping this distance to be in meters. Okay? So for a very small distance, we are trying to find out the amount of loss that is happening. Okay? So that is one of the biggest change that you are observing, that the distance involved here is much, much smaller. And that is quite obvious, because suppose you are making the measurement of loss for an environment or for a class of 7 to 4 for this particular room. So you cannot have a kilometer wide class, okay? So it should be meters. So the measurement is to be done with the assumption that D is primarily in meters that is considered, or it's very smaller, okay? And the second one is also very important, that the variability of environment is much greater for a smaller range of transmitter receiver separation. Why? By this, what we are looking at is, suppose for example you take TT ground floor, okay, TT as a building you consider first, and TT ground floor is the one that we are looking at. Now if you can observe, just to think in this way, then in ground floor we don't have any classroom. Do we have any classroom in the ground floor? I don't think so. There is a, in the corner we have the cabins, then we have this big hall, then if we go there are some labs present, the CTS office is there, in the corner also there is one, the Ambedkar, right? The lower one, the ground floor Ambedkar, right? That is there. So we have a corridor and the main entrance, and if you go this side we have sense office, the lift is there, but that's it. So there is no classroom, okay? Now if there is no classroom, so ground floor is having a particular pattern of obstacles. Now, if you go to second floor, suppose, of the same building, you have different classrooms present. Also, along with that, you might have different sets of labs, like the 231. I'm sitting in 231, so that's in second floor. So it is ADSP lab. So the labs will have, so for a very short duration, within a short transmitter-receiver separation, you are actually getting a lot of change or a variability in the environment that you are looking at. So that is the beauty of this indoor environment. In outdoor, it might not happen. Suppose for a 50 kilometers range, when you are making a measurement, or within a 10 kilometers range, you might come across that there is no obstacle at all. Okay, it might be only a plain field that you are looking at. Or maybe if it is a hill, it is stretching for 50 kilometers. It might be the case. So for long distance in outdoor environment, the variability of environment is not that much random. What is random in indoor environment? Because in indoor environment, you have to consider, and if you just focus on TT itself, which you can relate more easily, each and every floor will have its own set of parameters. Each floor has its own set of labs, centers, okay, classroom size are different, okay. So all this will add up to the different sets of laws that is happening. So that is the second point that we are looking at, that the variability of environment is much greater for a much smaller range of transmitter receiver separation. So please note it down or identify or understand the basic difference that we are making from outdoor to indoor environment. Okay, because these are some of the comparative questions usually you can associate. Okay, how it is different, why we are doing it. So this is why we are doing it, because the analysis for indoor environment is somehow different with that of the outdoor environment, or the assumptions that we are making, okay, they are different. The next set of information is that the propagation inside the building, okay, is affected by the layout of the building. Now this is also quite crucial, because suppose you are making such a measurement of a building of TT, it will give you some value of X. But suppose you go to SJT, which again you can relate, you go to SJT building structure or the layout is completely different to that of TT, right? So what indoor model is giving us an idea that the reading that we are getting for the layout of TT will be varying from that of the one that we are getting for SJT. Now it depends on the layout of the building as well as the material in which we are making the measurement. Because suppose in here you have a concrete wall, but back there it might not be an exact concrete wall there. Maybe the materials are different. Okay, that I'm not aware of, because that's a mechanical or civil people can mostly be telling us. But most of the cases, what will happen, the materials, how it differs, each materials will provide an amount of loss to the overall, it will add to the overall loss that is happening to the system. Till now, if you can remember, in outdoor model, we haven't considered this factor. Layout was not a factor. We were measuring it as it is. But now the layout of the building is also a factor. So if you can imagine, when we are making an overall measurement for a particular city or a particular region, we have to do both, or the operator should be doing both the outdoor measurement as well as the indoor measurement. Because they might come across that for a particular scenario, outdoor effect or the outdoor signal quality is good, but something is happening inside the building, that's why the signal is coming down. So they have to do the indoor propagation model, they have to analyze the particular building. Based on that, they have to do the necessary adjustments. Okay. So that's what the layout of the building, and again, it's as mentioned, construction material. How it is being made up? This is more relevant when you compare the office buildings. Suppose you consider any IT companies, like which you can refer to or which I can actually relate to. You can see there are partitions present, right? Now those partitions are not hard partitions, they are soft partitions. They are not brick wall. They are in between some partitions are given. Now all those keeps on changing office to office, right? Now you will soon find, I'll give you a tabulation, you will find there that each of this partition or the way it has been made to work in that office environment, it will be different. So that's why the construction material has a role to play for the indoor model. We'll see a problem exactly with respect to this material, in fact. And naturally, you can see the building type, that if it is an office area, it will be different. If it is a residential home, it will be different. If it is a factory, it will be different. Because the factory, if you have it, they have different sets of instruments. They will have the different sets of layout. The materials might be different. Okay, so all those things are taken into consideration. Now, if you can relate this one, I guess most of you might be doing it. LT experiment we have done, finished doing it in your lab. There, when you are dropping down the menu for the path loss model, we had indoor home, indoor factory, indoor like something was there. Three conditions were there. So that is basically the thing is like that. Okay, so where you are making a measurement, what is the layout, what are the construction materials that we are using are important for indoor model. Next is that indoor propagation is dominated by the mechanism like the reflection, diffraction, scattering. So they are the same. Okay. And the conditions are much more variable, like the door or window open or not. See, very insignificant thing, like this door or these windows are open. Okay, we don't worry much because this doesn't have a role to play in our signal quality degradation. But as far as the indoor model is concerned, when you are taking it, the close, if this door is closed, it will give you, it is supposed to give you a different set of attenuation, and if it is open, it should supposed to give you a different attenuation. And even you can see, suppose in this particular room, I think I have given this example before. You can see here there are two doors, one here, one at the back. This is very rare to many of the rooms because you will have only one door in most of the cases. So that might add to the overall loss to the system. Okay. So that's how it is. Next is, this is the, what are the building types that we have. As we know already, I think I have told most of the cases, residential homes in suburban areas, residential homes in urban areas. So the constructions are different. In urban areas, you will find lots of multi-storied building, 5 feet, 5-6 flats, okay. So they will have different multi-storied building, but whereas in our suburban areas, you won't get that much of a big high rise. So that's how it differs. Okay. So factory building, grocery stores, retail stores, everywhere the making is different. Just imagine, just visualize the whole concept. Everything is different. The making, the makeup of the whole store is different in each of the cases. So each one will give you a different set of value. Now this is what is very interesting. I don't think you might be imagining this, but you can see the third point. Empty cardboard box. Okay, it's a very common thing that we usually have, the empty cardboard box. We'll just throw it, dump it like that. But if you can observe that for a 1300 megahertz, as it gets mentioned over there, okay, almost around 3 to 8 dB of attenuation is happening only from an empty cardboard box. So that's what the indoor propagation model is, where you are taking into account all these scenarios, which are very insignificant it might seem, but basically as with respect to RF communication, they all provide amount of loss. Even you can observe there, the dry plywood of this different inches, it produces most of the cases at 1 dB or 4 dB based on the frequency of operation. Always very negligible, 1 dB is not that much, but it does provide one. And even you can see concrete block wall or the metal partition, they're 26 dB at around 815 megahertz. 815 is almost equivalent to working for a GSM band. So for a metal partition, if you have it, you are supposed to get an attenuation of around 26 dB from metal, from a metallic body, or if there is any partition. Okay, so that's how the significance is. Now if you ask me how are we calculating this, this is again kind of an empirical thing. We have a meter, we go and on measuring at different frequencies what is the value of loss that we are getting. Okay. So that's how we are getting it. There are multiple losses that might happen of the materials. Please refer Rapoport, because in Rapoport you will find that you have a different set of all sets of attenuators and their corresponding losses at a particular frequency range. Now you have this is also quite interesting. In fact, this is a realistic study which was conducted long time back. But the important significance is that there is one term which is mentioned over here, and that is called as FAF. This FAF is known as floor attenuation factor. We will be using this particular parameter later in today's class. So you can see here there are three different companies which are present. Okay, so these are the companies. So one, there is two, and there is three. The main thing that differs in each of the company is that this is a two-storied, whereas this is a five-storied, this is a third floor. So each one of them are defining by the number of floors that they have. Now each of these floors for a particular building will add to the loss, and that should be considered to be as floor attenuation factor. So suppose you are making a measurement, you forget about this one, if you are making a measurement for a TT has how many number of floors? You had 7 floors, right? This is now 7th floor, you have the top floor as 8th floor. But if you suppose go to SJT is having 8th floor. 8th floor is the controller's COE office. On top of it, you have the roof. Now you go to SMB, I don't know how many floors are there. I think 4 or 2. 2 is there. So 2 is there. So if you consider that, ideally, you will have different sets of reading for floor attenuation factor. And ideally, it has been observed that for lower number of floors, the more you have the number of floors, the floor attenuation factor keeps on coming down. Okay, so the losses are lesser. So you can observe here as well that fourth floor for this particular instance is 27 dB, whereas for fifth floor it is only 27.1. Compared to when you consider the first floor is to be 13.2 dB and the second floor is having a difference of almost 5 dB or 18 dB. Or you can see here it is around 33.6, whereas in the second floor it is having 44. So that's one of the observations being made, that more the number of buildings or the, if it is a very high rise at on top floors, okay, you will get the least amount, or not least, but it, the floor attenuation factor won't change that much from the earlier floors. So one of the observations, okay, that's one of the observations. So these are the things. This is done with respect to 915 megahertz. Now if you can observe that when we are looking at 1900 megahertz, the frequency range, if we increase the values, okay, the value somehow decreases. So more the frequency that we are going to use, the lesser is the chance of the loss happening for the same scenario. And that's one of the reason why we are now preferring to work on gigahertz range for ISM band or 2.4 gigahertz and beyond. That's because one of the factor is this particular instance. So the loss factor or the floor attenuation factor is coming down. What is the significance of floor attenuation factor coming down? I'll show you with an equation. But the observation is that it is showing a drastic improvement in the floor attenuation factor. Okay, we'll see that at the conclusion once again. So based on this, we come across a particular equation. Please note down this equation, because this is the only model that we are going to follow for our indoor propagation model. There are many other models, but instead of going for that, and those are not that conclusive, this one is actually one of the preferred or widely used model, and that is known as the attenuation factor model. Now if you can observe in this attenuation factor model, this ideally is very similar to that of the log distance, or rather log normal shadowing model. Why? Because you can see this is my free space path loss. So this is my free space path loss, which is again given by minus 10 log of lambda square by 4 pi whole square d square. Okay, so this already we already have proved, and we have done problems using this. So this is my case. This part comes under log distance. Remember 10 eta, we had a proportionality constant of d by d naught. To equate the whole thing, we had this 10 eta. So this eta part is the path attenuation factor. This is the path loss exponent. So this is my path loss exponent. This is actually the logarithmic scale. So this is fine. And somehow this part, FAF plus PAF, is actually indicating some kind of an x sigma for us. If you can remember the log normal or the log normal shadowing model, it was something like this also, PL D naught plus 10 eta log of D
d by d naught plus x sigma. This was the equation for log normal shadowing model. So somehow this x sigma is somehow looking something like this. And what are these two factors? FAF, as I told you, as for floor, and PAF is nothing but partition attenuation factor. So what type of materials are you are using? Those materials will have an attenuation to be added along with the floor attenuation that you have. So if I go a bit more detail on that x sigma part or the loss factor, this is what it is, it will really look like. So the first thing is PAF, and it is an I. Why I have given I? It means that basically I equal to 1 to NP is the number of partitions that you have. Okay? So number of partitions, so the first partition will have some attenuation, plus second partition, third partition. Partition means the materials being used. You add up everything. So for the particular floor, this will be the amount of partition loss. For the particular floor, we will have a particular floor attenuation factor. We will add up, and that will give us the total partition loss, or LPL. This is to be added with 10 eta log of d by d naught and the free stress particles to obtain the total loss for that particular floor and for that particular office building, or for any building for that matter. Is it clear what we are trying to do? Even you can see here, FAF is nothing but a summation. So we are summing it up over the interval 1 to F, where NF is nothing but the number of floors. So when it is first floor, we'll consider 1. But suppose we are looking at an equation where there are 2 floors. So basically you have to add up the 2 floor attenuation factors. That's how the whole process works. So based on this, this is the equation as I was telling you. I guess it's clear, it's not that difficult, because it's the same thing that we are repeating in a different form. Based on this, can we come across a problem or numerical of this nature? Can we solve a numerical? Please make your full attention to understand this type of a problem. Okay? Because this is a very important and very interesting, in fact. It's not difficult at all. It's very interesting in a way. So the question is, considering this figure as the top view of an office floor, using the attenuation factor model, estimate the total overall path loss for room number L5 and room number R7. Considering partition loss due to reinforced concrete brick wall, brick partition, metal partition and aluminium sliding windows as given by these values respectively. Also consider the reference distance d naught at 1 meter and carrier frequency of 900 megahertz. So as you can observe, even the floor attenuation factor is given as 30 dB. Assuming the receivers in each room are at the center of the room. Finally, and also choose the path loss exponent as per your own assumption. Okay? So how can we approach to this problem? Okay, we have to use the attenuation factor model for the room L5 and R7. So what we are going to do is, basically in order to do that, we have the two component already present. So LF, let me do one thing. So we have this over here. Okay. Now we want to make sure we are using loss as LF plus 10 eta log of d by d naught plus summation of FAF plus summation of PAF. Right? So this is the equation that we have. Now ideally FAF should be summed up, but here it's only one floor. So we are only bothered with 30 dB itself. So this summation we don't need. It's only 30 dB, so that's okay. Now going to the next half. Okay, so LF again, the use the formula 10 eta. So it is 10 eta, 10 log of lambda square by 4 pi whole square d square. What will be the value of eta? In the question it is asked to find out, you can consider eta as per your own justification. What will be the value of eta? What we can consider? What do you think that path law's exponent we can have? Path law's exponent, you remember I showed you one tabulation also. Okay, in that there are different values, but I told you there are, in if nothing is given, we will assume the value of eta to be at least some value, somewhere in the range. So what was the range and why it was the range? Ideally, remember that most of the cases the eta will be considered between 3 to 4, 3 or 4, because if you can remember, 3 to 5 was the range for shadowed urban region, that's what the eta value. So if we consider eta somewhere as 4, you can take 3 as well or 3.5 as well, no problem. And your left D naught is also known to you. The only factor that remains unsolved is D. Okay. So let's see how we can find out D. Can anyone tell me how can we for L5? So we are somewhere here. How can we find out what is the value of D? D is the difference between the distance between the transmitter and the receiver. What can be the value of D? Just think of it, it's very simple. Just think of it a little bit. That's what you are supposed to do during your CAT 2 as well. Okay. Our hot questions will be something very similar to this only. Think of it, what? Because you need PAF. FAF is anyway 30, which is given to you. You are left with PAF, which will come later. And you need the D. D is unknown here. So what will be D? For L5, if our reference is this particular room. This is our reference. What will be the value of D? Anyone? Sorry? No, I didn't get it. D?
Value of D?
Yeah, value of D? How do you calculate? Simple, that's it. Nothing else. You actually make sure that you write a, you kind of create a triangle somewhere over here. Because if you can go back to the, if I just go back to the question, the receivers are at the center of the room and the transmitter, we can assume that it's also at the center of the generation. Okay, so basically you are looking at a scenario where you are making a triangle look like this. Okay, if it is visible, yeah, it's visible. So you have to just calculate the distance here. Like if it is I mentioned the name as maybe the triangle A, B and we have C. So just triangle the value, you have to calculate the distance between AB and BC and then you try to find the calculate the hypotenuse. So can anyone tell me what will be the value of AB? Can anyone tell me what will be the value of AB? AB is nothing but this distance added to this one, added to this part, maybe this half, so this goes like this. And this half. So this is the total, the red color arrow is actually indicating the total distance. Now if you go back here, this distance is 5, this is 7, R3 is very equivalent to R5, which is 2 again. So this is 5 plus 7, so I am writing here 5 plus 7 plus 2 plus this one is 7 plus 2. Is it fine for all of you? What we did, we are just calculating the distance. So this becomes how much? 21. Okay. So this is, let me see whether I have taken it correctly. 5, 7, 2, 7, 2. That's okay. Now, what will be BC, this value? This value. This is half of it, right? So this is half. This distance is 10. This distance is 10, right? So the half of it is 5. So this distance is 5. So this point, this is 5. And what about the upper half? 2.5. So it's 7.5. So basically, your BC is 2.5. So you get the two distance of the perpendicular and the base, and you can kind of find out the what is the hypotenuse for you. So that's what be the D, because that D you require to substitute over here. Any doubt with this? Can anyone tell me what will be D when you are considering R7? What will be the value of D when you are considering the R7 room? Suppose you are trying to find out what is the loss happening for R7. So what will be the value of D? So D is something like A, whatever is value. So R7 is here. So you have this. You have this. Again 2. 7. 2. R6. What is the value of R6? R6, naturally from the dimension of the room, you have to consider that R1 and R6 are almost similar. And total minus 1. Yes, that's what. I was coming to that. That also we can do. We can subtract the overall. We know the total, whatever the distance, minus the 7 and 7. That also, I think 7 and 3.5. Yes, that also we can do. No problem with that. I was looking at it because the other one we solved it in the same manner. That's why the same pattern I was following. So that also you can do. So that will give you the value of this nature, okay, this half. Similarly, you can get some value of this triangle, okay, this value. So this is again, I guess it will be once again 7.5, if I'm not wrong, because it's uniform, so it's again will be 7.5. So you can get the value of D for that part. So from the equation LF, we are now understood, it's already we done previously. In here, eta assumption we know, D we have found out in our own way, FAF is 30 given, so the only point to remember is PAF. Now, what to do with PAF? Okay, so let's see whether I can copy and paste it once again. Okay, let me just... Okay, so now this is my diagram. Okay, so this is my diagram once again. Now just refer to L5, the room L5. Partition attenuation loss is, or partition attenuation factor is, how many partitions does the transmitted signal has come and been reflected or refracted or like the diffracted before coming to that room or the receiver. How many obstacle does it face before coming to the receiver? That's what we are going to calculate. So if you consider L5, if you consider L5 in here, the signal comes in somewhere here. So this is one set of impinge. It is coming somewhere there. It is also hitting somewhere here. If I am a little bright color, if you possibly can. Then it hits somewhere here. Okay. It goes to hit somewhere here. So these points are the partitions or partition losses. Now we can see the green one that I have indicated over here, this is nothing but brick partition. So one is brick partition. So brick partition, if I consider one, so once it has hit the brick partition, then it has come somewhere over here where it is hitting an aluminium window, right? So that's AL window. So this is once it is hitting okay, it is coming here, but here while it's coming, it is impinging on a metal partition, because this is a metal partition. So metal partition is again once, and then it goes here, this, so metal partition once again. So you have two metal partitions, one plus one. So basically, once it hits the brick partition, once it hits the aluminium window, twice it hits the metal partition. Now if you go back to the problem, each one of these partitions have their own set of losses. So in the equation, you have to add, this is my brick, no, this is my brick partition, second one. So 3.1 plus aluminium is having 20.4. So 3.1 plus 20.4 plus twice that of 2060. So if I write it once again here, the value that we are looking at, so PAF will look something like, what are the values? 3.1, that's because of the brick, plus 20 point something, which is for the aluminium, and twice that of 26 dB for the loss. So this you have to consider for the summation factor of PAF. Okay, so can anyone tell me, if I just go back, what will be the partition loss for R7? Or rather, you tell me how many times the obstacles are coming into picture when we are calculating it. So let me just do it this way. Okay, so I'll write metal, okay, brick, aluminium, and brick wall, like this. So how many times does it goes through the metal partition? How many times it goes through a metal partition? It goes somewhere here, it comes somewhere, goes here, it impinges somewhere here. Is there anywhere it is hitting? No. So metal partition 3 times. Now how many times it is hitting the brick wall? Is it hitting the brick wall? Brick partition, that is brick partition. Brick wall, nothing. Because brick wall is this one. It's not hitting anything of that nature. So bold, the complete bold line is indicating the brick wall. So it's not hitting it. Brick, the brick partition, it is hitting somewhere actually here. It is both hitting the aluminium window as well as the brick partition. So that's one. And anywhere else? No. So I think brick partition is one. Aluminium window, it is hitting somewhere here. So it's only one. And that's more like it. Okay, so for R7, when you are calculating PAF, is nothing but metal partition multiplied by 3 plus the brick partition, whatever the value is, plus aluminium window of this much. This sums up to the summation of PAF, which is given over here. Okay, so if I go back to the equation once again, now I guess it will be clear for you. So all these components you have to find out one by one, substitute it to get the value for each of the floors. Now this you calculate for one floor. The problem that we have here is for one floor. Now suppose you have multiple floors. So you just have to add that floor attenuation factor, which will be given. Naturally a tabulation will be given to you, where you have to add the floors, multiple floors, one by one. Is it clear with this problem? Is it fine? So this is the type of problem you are supposed to get in your CAT 2 as well, because they are very much like intuitive. You have to go through one by one. So please remember how to solve it. Any doubt with the process? Okay. So let us move ahead. This is also a very important graph. Okay, we are only finishing with two slides after this. So this is a very important graph for us. Why? Two things it conveys. Okay. One thing is, can anyone tell me whether this graph, okay, of the distance versus path loss is indicating for outdoor environment or an indoor environment? My question is whether this particular graph, okay, of path loss versus distance is showing us a graph for indoor or an outdoor environment. Okay, if the answer is, if he is asking is indoor, naturally the question is why?
Why it is an indoor?
It says office building. Okay, that's okay. I'll remove that office building in your final. Divyanshu, anything? Floors are given. You see, suppose I remove the office building, I remove the legend there, and I give you this graph. Still then, you might identify that this is a indoor propagation model. How? Transmitter to receiver distance is given in meters. This is the factor, not the number of floors or office. Those, if I remove it, nothing matters. But this is in meters. This is one of the assumptions being made in the first case, that indoor model works when the distance of separation is small. This type of question you might be asked to. Direct question won't be there. So this is one of the observation. That's one, first of the observation. Second is, you can see there are various eta values which we have considered over here, the graph shows. Now you can see one very important aspect. If you can remember, if I just go back, I can go back once again. But eta equals to 2 accounts for a free space path loss. Free space path loss is in some way very much related to a line of sight propagation. So less loss. So you can see here, when we are considering eta equals to 2 or less than that, very few points lies on the loss factor. And the losses are less, because it's a line of sight we are looking at. Even you can see here, there are more of the circles present. Now circles indicates the same floor. Okay, so that's the ground floor that we are kind of making a measurement. So less than eta by eta equal to 2, you will always get a favorable condition. So that's why we'll not choose eta in any of our numericals. We'll choose 3, 4. Why? Because 3 and 4 actually is indicating that most of the loss, as the red circle is pointing out, most of the loss is happening when the value is eta equal to 3 and 4 for an office building. And as you can observe that for different floors, the values are almost like clubbed together in the same manner. So the more you are looking at 110 or 120 dB, okay, you can see 120 is it's there, but more of the transmitter receiver separation is more. And for each and every cases, when the eta is changing, the loss also can be plotted in this particular manner. So the concept is that this portion, whatever we are looking at, this is eta equal less than 2. Okay, so that's why loss is very, very less. But whereas whenever we are going away, or you are extending your study beyond eta equal to 2, the more of the loss factor is coming. So it is more correct in predicting the loss. So that's the big significance of this particular graph. It's again given in Rapoport, not explained in this manner maybe, but the graph is taken from Rapoport itself. So this is also one very important study of the attenuation factor model. Finally, we conclude our discussion with one of these factors which already we had finished discussing actually, that mostly this frequency or the penetration loss that we call it, this penetration loss, mostly it will depend on the effect of frequency as well as the effect of height. As I was telling you, the frequency, when it goes on increasing, the factor for loss is coming down. Okay, so RF signals can penetrate from outside transmitter to the inside of buildings, and the loss of the penetration will vary according to the frequency at which we are working on. So this is one of the very interesting finding out. We already had discussed this. And the other one is the effect of height, where I told you that the height at some, after a certain period, even with increasing height, the floor attenuation factor remains almost constant. It doesn't change. It doesn't mean that the value will come down. The value, magnitude of the value will be high, but it won't drastically change from one floor to another. That's being observed. Okay. So these are the two very important observations that we can have. And so that's more like it. So this concludes our discussion on the overall large scale fading at large. We'll start with the small scale fading. But before finishing off with that note, many of you were discussing or asking me that what are the portions we have completed so far. So this is kind of a recap of what we did. We started with the basic propagation mechanism in which the reflection, diffraction, scattering, that what we did.
In that reflection, we had studied the two-ray models and all. So, and all diffraction, we had studied the knife edge geometry. Log normal and log distance shadowing, these are the two primary practical link budget model that we had studied. On top of it, we had studied the outdoor propagation model, in which Okumura model and Hata model we specifically emphasized on. And based on that, we had solved very specific numericals where we had a solution of how correct predictor an Okumura or a Hata model is. And finally, we had done the indoor propagation model today, which actually is completely different to that of what the Okumura or the outdoor model considered is to be, because there are many factors which might not be taken into consideration that seriously by us. But it has been found out that those materials also contribute to the loss factor. Okay, so that's being estimated using the attenuation factor model. So that's what we have finished. So from Monday onwards, because tomorrow is a quiz, so Monday onwards we'll start with the small scale fading. There we will find the rapidness or the randomness of the signal, how to counteract the channel. Okay, how do we get a knowledge of the channel fading, and we can work on that, because the loss part we have done with it. Okay, now we have to check, we have to predict the channel, how to predict the channel, how to understand how the channel will behave. So that will come under the small scale fading. Okay, thank you.